This recording is protected by copyright. No part may be reproduced without the prior permission of the University of South Australia.
Good evening, everybody. It's wonderful to see you all here. Thank you so much for coming along to this very special presentation. My name is Jacinta Thompson, and I'm the Executive Director of the Bob Hawke Prime Ministerial Centre. I would like to acknowledge that we are on Kaurna land and pay tribute to the Kaurna people, the traditional owners of the land we meet on. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs and relationship with the land. I would also like to welcome you all here tonight on behalf of the Hawke Centre and the University of South Australia for the presentation of Mind Change, How Digital Technologies Are Leaving Their Mark on Our Brains, to be delivered by Baroness Susan Greenfield. I warmly welcome you here, Baroness Susan, and we are delighted that you could join us actually in person for a face-to-face conversation rather than across the television, radio, digital airwaves. So thank you so much for joining us here in Adelaide. We are very pleased to be co-presenting tonight's session with RI Oz, and I would like to personally thank Paul Willis, Director, and Bradley Abraham, who is the General Manager. The Hawke Centre is committed to delivering a diverse program of events and their free events and exhibitions throughout the year, which reflect our fundamental themes: strengthening our democracy, valuing our diversity, and building our future. And we aim to honour these themes through our accessible and thought-provoking programs that engage not only with our South Australian community, but our global audience. The session tonight is being recorded, and a podcast and a video of the event will be available on the Hawke Centre next week. As we have a full house, I would encourage you to bring this to the attention of your friends and colleagues who have missed out on coming tonight, and so they can have a listen and see the video as well next week. And talking of digital technology, can I please ask that you switch phones to silent to avoid interruptions, but please feel free to join the Twitter conversation. Oh, we don't have it behind us. Do we know? I think it's on the form. Did everyone get a piece of paper with? Hopefully, yep. Okay, great. Sorry about that. Technology failed. I would now like to invite Professor Richard Head, who is the Deputy Vice Chancellor, Research and Innovation at UniSA, to introduce our speaker for tonight. Thank you, Richard.
Thank you, Jacinta, and welcome all. It's my pleasure to welcome you to the Bob Hawke Ministerial Centre lecture entitled Mind Change, How Digital Technologies Are Leaving Their Mark on Our Brains. I'd like to welcome all distinguished guests here today and those joining us from Interstate, RA Oz and the University of South Australia. This evening, I'm honoured to introduce our speaker, Baroness Susan Greenfield. Professor Greenfield and myself have worked over many years, and particularly here in Adelaide a decade ago, with Linda Cooper on the BRAG initiative, and its events and what flowed from that has been truly remarkable. Baroness Susan Greenfield is known worldwide as a key neuroscientist, writer, broadcaster, and as a member of the House of Lords. In a remarkable career, she's been awarded 30 honorary degrees from universities worldwide and received numerous accolades, such as the Michael Faraday Medal from the Royal Society, from the Legion of Honour from the French government, the American Academy of Achievement Golden Plate Award, and the Australian Medical Research Society Medal. In addition, Baroness Greenfield has been elected to various honorary fellowships at the Royal College of Physicians, the Royal Society of Edinburgh, and the Institute of Risk Management. Baroness Greenfield's research specialises in the physiology of the brain and examines the impact that the 21st century technologies have on the mind, and particularly how the brain generates consciousness and novel approaches to the degenerative diseases such as Alzheimer's and Parkinson's disease. She presents her findings regularly in many mediums, including radio, television, and print, which is available to both the public and the private sector. The lecture this evening will explore the marked effect of that cyber technology that has on our modern 21st century society. Baroness Greenfield will challenge us to consider how the relatively recent emergence of instant information and ever-expanding connections and networks have impacted on the human brain through the creation of this new fast-paced environment. As with the global phenomena, for example, of climate change, the lecture will demonstrate how this era of mind change will be shaped by what we decide to do about it, as it is surely the most far-reaching and exciting challenge of our time. I would like to thank the Hawke Centre, RA Oz, for organising tonight's lecture, and I trust that you'll enjoy and be challenged by Baroness Greenfield's lecture this evening. With such a diverse group of people in the room, I'm sure that interesting and thought-provoking discussion will evolve from innovative material being presented this evening. Thank you.
Oh, good evening, everyone. Richard, thank you very much for that very generous introduction. However, you missed out a really important accolade I've had. You know what it is? In 2006, I was Honorary Australian of the Year at Australia House in London. You might ask what qualified me for this. I'm not quite sure, actually. I was supposed to be showing Australian values. However, it doesn't help me in immigration at Sydney Airport, I've noticed, but so, and it's, but I have got the plaque, and that's what counts. Yeah. So what we're all here to do this evening is to explore something that's going to affect us all, because we're all citizens of the 21st century, and what's very lovely to see is so many different generations here, and yet I think it's no single generation that is going to be affected. We all are, because we're all hopefully going to live a long and healthy life. There was a comedian in Britain called Eric Morecambe, you may have heard of him, in Morecambe and Wise, said, one thing I want to do before I die, live a long time. And given that's what we all want to do, and there's a one in three chance now of living to be 100, I think it's something that is affecting us all, because clearly this is, I'm going to argue, an impact on our whole lives and how we think and how we feel that will determine what kind of society we're going to live in. And if I can achieve anything this evening, let me say, I'm not going to bring tablets down from the mountaintop, but what I think would be brilliant is if when you leave this evening, you are arguing with each other. I think that'd be fantastic. If you can be talking and arguing and disagreeing, and that's when we have a healthy society. That's how we can progress. So here is the society, and because, as you've heard, I'm a neuroscientist, clearly we're going to be seeing this through the prism of the physical brain. Now, I imagine there must be in a room so large some professional neuroscientists, neurologists, psychiatrists, and the like here. I won't ask you to put your hands up because you probably won't anyway. People never do. But can I just say, bear with me, because I'm assuming that most people are not demon neuroscientists, in which case I would like to start with some basics, which if you're a professional, you may know very well, but I think nonetheless, even if you are, it's important to remind yourself just how astonishing every single person in this room is, because you are a unique individual. And no one for the 100,000 years that we've stalked this planet as a species has a brain like yours, nor will they ever again. And even if you are an identical twin, that's to say a clone, you are not the same as your twin. You are special, and no one will ever be like you. And it's not due to your hearts or your lungs or your liver or indeed your genes. It's due to what has happened inside your physical brain. And I love this picture of the brain, because it reminds me, I've said this many times, of when I was first dissecting a brain at university. And I apologize if this makes you feel a bit queasy. I did this once at a school, and the child did actually throw up, which was a bit... So I'm sure you're much more sophisticated than that. Anyway, so I asked you to imagine that they wheel in these trolleys, in Tupperware plastic buckets, and You're wearing surgical gloves, inevitably, but I was thinking as I put my hand in to the fixative and bought the formalin and held the brain in one hand, what would happen if I wasn't wearing gloves and a bit of brain tissue got under my fingernail? You know, would that be the bit that somebody loved with? You know, can you have love under your fingernail? Or could you have a memory at the beach under your fingernail? Well, it's true. I mean, that's it. Or could you have a habit like biting your fingernail under your fingernail? Yeah, so this is why being neuroscientist drives you mad. You know, they're just crazy. So the more you think about it, the more you just go around in cartwheels, because it is the most astonishing feat that you have something, a sludgy, boring thing, let's be brutal. You know, it's not very spectacular to look at, is it? It looks like a wrinkled walnut. And yet, it is everything you are. It's everything you are. So what we're going to look at first is how this miracle is achieved. Well, I'll try and explain a little bit. We still don't know, of course, all the final details, but I'll try and give you a picture of what we know so far. And why, therefore, because, as I'm going to show you, the brain is so sensitive to the environment that if the environment is changing, it means the brain's going to change. So let's start first with some basic neuroscience, and this is probably the fastest neuroscience course in the world. Yeah. It'll last for about 5 slides. But just in case you have had a hard day, the conclusion is written up as the title. So if you do sort of, and I know I talk first, so if your mind wanders, your neighbor will nudge you when they see a number and a statement, and that's the conclusion. So we have in advance the conclusion, which is the environment is key. Now, let's explore that a little bit. This is the Innocent Drinks Company, which is a very big smoothie manufacturer in the UK. You may have seen them, I don't know if you've traveled, but the logo is of an angel with a little halo because there's no alcohol, no nasties, no anything. And they do very well, and they're a very innovative, funky kind of company. And as befits such a mission, they have, this is their headquarters, rather strange office, you can see with AstroTurf, and that's an old London telephone box, and sort of benching and things. And the whole idea, and this is quite valid, is that if you're in a stimulating environment, it will make you think in a stimulating, novel, innovative way. So that's the thinking behind it. Now let's look at the physiology. Let's start with how we all started off life. Yeah. Why are we different from goldfish, say? You know, what is it? Let's be brutal. Goldfish don't have great personalities, do they? I hope I don't offend any goldfish. In fact, there were some goldfish floating on one of the slides. Yeah. And that if your kids had a pet goldfish and it died, you could sneak off to the pet shop and buy another goldfish while they were at school. Yeah. Perhaps you've done this. And they wouldn't know any different when they came home. Yeah. Because the goldfish has such a limited repertoire, all it does is float around flapping its fins and open and shutting its mouth. Whereas you couldn't do that with a pet cat or dog, and even if they wanted you to, you couldn't do it with their brothers or sisters. And this is because as we have evolved, as we become more sophisticated, so we escape the tyranny of our genes. That's not to say genes aren't important, of course they are, but the relationship between the genes and what you're finally doing becomes more and more and more diluted and indirect as we become more sophisticated. And the balance shifts away from the very restricted repertoire that characterizes the behavior of a goldfish to the complex, varied, rich, diverse, highly individual behaviors that make you the person you are. And what we're going to do is look at how that happens. It's something neuroscientists call plasticity. It doesn't mean to say that the brain is made of plastic, of course. It comes from the original term in Greek, plastikos, to be molded. So what we're going to look at is seeing how your brain is molded. And what I'm going to argue and try and persuade you is that as you grow, your interaction of your physical brain with the environment is going to do something amazing. It's going to personalize your brain into what I would call the mind. I get so fed up with philosophers, and I'm not going to ask if there's philosophers here, there may well be, and again, they don't fess up until the question time when they ask very technical questions that reveals their profession. But, you know, sometimes philosophers think that they're the ones dealing with all these wonderful exotic emotions of, you know, the mind and the individual and free will and consciousness, and that has nothing to do with the squalor of the physical brain and the sort of chemistry and people like me are grubbing away working in. And what I hope to show you first is that that is utterly, utterly not the case, and that however exotic and ephemeral your emotions and your thoughts might seem, they have a physical basis, deep down and dirty in the brain cells. So let's look at that. So this is what happens when you're born. Forgive me, professionals, if I call the blobby bits, they're in fact brain cells, neurons, And I'd like you to focus on the stringy bits, which are the connections between them. And you can see, even in the first few months of life, there is astonishing change in the human brain that accounts for its growth. And look, by 2 years, I hope you could notice that what we're having here is not so much a proliferation of the blobby bits, the brain cells. But if you remember anything, remember this, it is the connections between them. It is the growth of the connections between brain cells that accounts for the growth of the brain after birth. And what we're going to look at is how the unique and individual experiences that you're about to have as you set out in life, they are literally going to change endlessly these connections. They're going to shape them and reconfigure them and strengthen them, and some will go into disuse because you're going to use it or lose it. And in a country such as this, which is so fanatical about sport, obviously I don't have to tell you that when you exercise certain muscle groups, they prosper, they become strong and efficient. And if, as happened with my brother, who broke his ankle recently, and he wasn't using his leg for a while, he was astonished how quickly his calf muscles weakened and seemed to shrivel and atrophy and so on. So we know you use it or lose it, and the same applies to the brain. So let's look at some examples of how when you're doing something, it will change the physical properties of the connections of your brain cells. So, okay, now, I don't know how many people have been to London, but this is a black cab, and this is an unusual picture because the driver is smiling. This very rarely happens, and even more astonishing, the passenger also is smiling. And now this is a truly rare occurrence here. Perhaps because of all these credit cards he takes. Yeah, that's probably why he's smiling, isn't ready for anything. I have to say, my experience in Melbourne of taxi drivers might be the control group for the experiment I'm about to describe, because London taxi drivers, and I think in Adelaide it's not the case either, London taxi drivers have to pass a 2-year exam. And that's not the case here, is it, in Australia? No. Well, they have to, no, I thought so. I think the Melbourne taxi driver said yesterday that they were going to introduce it, and of the 300 candidates that had gone in for this, one person had passed it, I think you said, and so they were thinking again. Anyway, because they have this huge burden on what's called their working memory, what they have to do is remember all the streets of London, all the one-way systems, so without recourse to a manual, and it is quite a feat for those of you who have had taken cabs in London, apart from the grumpy demeanor that they usually have, that they can remember how to go from A to B, and they recite this to an examiner without looking at anything. So this is something that is exercising their working memory, more than for ordinary human beings, ordinary mortals. Now, what's fascinating in an our classic study, where they scanned the brains of London taxi drivers, they found that an area called the hippocampus, and that's shown here in two different sections, lighting up, this area of the brain is related, one of many areas related to memory, spatial memory. And what they did was to look in scans at the size of the hippocampus of London taxi drivers compared to ordinary mortals. And what they found was that it was bigger in London taxi drivers than in other people because they were using their memory all the time. This is a fact not lost on London taxi drivers. Next time you take a cab in London, ask if they've heard of the hippocampus. They all have. And it's not that having a big hippocampus predisposes you to being a London taxi driver, because the difference is more marked, as you can see here, for the longer they've been driving. So this is an example of the use it or lose it. Now, it's not just London taxi driving. There's many examples of so-called plasticity, where you look at different groups of people who do unusual or difficult or special things for protracted periods of time, and indeed you can see changes in their brain. So let's have a quick look. We've just seen taxi drivers. Any mathematicians here? Here we are. Time spent as a mathematician is not wasted. It induces gray matter density in the cortex is the outer layer of the brain, so called after the Latin for bark, because it wraps around the brain like bark wraps around a tree. Anyway, you can see mathematicians and a certain bit of their outer layer of their brain that's bigger. Anyone play golf here? Change seen in the golfer's brain, but you have to be skilled, notice. I don't know how they assign this. Basketball players, I don't know if Adelaide goes in for basketball. Again, you can see changes. And back to musicians, between musicians and non-musicians that are practicing, you can see again. So think of these widely different groups, taxi drivers, mathematicians, golfers, basket players, musicians. The theme is the same. Whether it's a seemingly mental activity or whether it's a physical one, it is leaving its mark in brain scans, measurable there, no argument. Now, also we can look at these changes not by taking special groups, but by taking ordinary human beings and training them up. And there's a wonderful experiment that I think we could talk about all evening that involved three groups of adult human volunteers, none of whom could play the piano at the beginning of this experiment. A word of advice, if ever you volunteer for an experiment like this, try and not be in the control group, because they just stared at a piano for 5 days. So you can see they missed out on that one, whereas the other group learnt five-finger piano exercises. But there's a third group that's the most fascinating of all. So let's look and see what happens. So here we're going from left to right, day one, obviously, through to day five. Okay, so the controls, these are scans of the relevant part of the brain relating to digits. And as you can see, in these five scans, they're all pretty much the same. The brain is literally unimpressed. Nothing's happened. Whereas, forget about being a taxi driver and training up for 2 years, these folk who were learning five-finger piano exercises, you can see an astonishing change in the brain territory even after 5 days, just because they're doing that, yeah? But the exciting group are the third group, because these people were merely asked to imagine they were playing the piano. Now, there's lots of things I think we could say about this. It's a truly astonishing experiment. First, we cannot talk about a distinction of physical versus mental, as you can see. Right. So any philosopher that seems to divide the world up into the exotic, the ephemeral, the abstract in which they deal with, and the squalid, and the basic, and the chemical that people like me work in, clearly is misleading for people. I think it's a very exciting notion that every thought you're having, of course we can't explain it, but that you have an abstract thought and there's a physical basis for it. I mean, if you think about it, that must be the case because of the placebo effect when you have a thought that something's going to make you better, and it does. Yeah. So clearly something's going on here, which I find really, really exciting. And as far as the brain's concerned, it is the thought that's important, obviously, because given that the physical and mental practice groups are so similar, as far as the brain is concerned, what is important is not the contraction of the muscle. It is the thought that has preceded it. Yeah. By the way, I've tried imagining I'm a millionaire. It doesn't work. So obviously it has limits, but I'm told that people imagine they're playing golf and they play better and so on. So let's get back to what thinking is then and what mental activities are. And there's a wonderful quote from a long time ago, from the 1960s, from a man who developed the treatment that's still in use for the movement disorder, Parkinson's disease. It's a man called Ole Hornikowitz, an Austrian physician. He said this: thinking is movement confined to the brain. So let's just unpack that for a moment, because I know it's been a long day probably, and it's been quite hot here, and it's probably a bit strange to suddenly be confronted with that. What is the difference between a thought and an emotion? Any thought and any emotion. Let me suggest to you my take on this. When you have an emotion, you're just in the moment. You go yuck or wow, or you laugh or you cry or you scream. And this is witnessed in children or babies, animals, the purring cat, the tail wagging dog. An emotion is just there. You're expressing yourself, you're emoting in some way, you're usually vocalizing, but it's over and done with. It's there in the moment and that's it. You've had an emotion. Whereas a thought is something else. Think of a business plan or a memory or a hope or a lie or a fantasy. A equals B, B equals C, so A equals C. What's happening there? You're ending up in a different place from where you started. Whatever kind of thought it was, you've gone in a linear sequence and you've ended up in a different place. And how did you get to that different place? Through a sequence of steps, a movement confined to the brain. And we're going to come back to this importance of linearity and of thought being different from emotion and the importance of thought to being human in terms of beginning, middle, end. A story, if you like. We'll come back to that, where you're ending up, you're traveling, you're ending up in a different place. And I think that's what you see here. The thought is the movement confined to the brain. Okay, so there's other examples of plasticity, as well as the piano players, and again, a whole varied range of activities. Why anyone would want to learn juggling for 7 days, again, but this is one of the things people do. And you can see structural changes just taking completely naive subjects and asking them to learn juggling. For those of you who are like me, getting on towards in the decades, older people, it's just the same. For older people, the juggling also, you can learn it and there are brain changes in just the same way. Younger people preparing for exams at the moment. Again, I'm not sure why the German Physikum exam was chosen, but again, as if they didn't have enough problems, these young people preparing for exams, they were being studied by neuroscientists who were measuring the hippocampus. And you can see again changes when they're preparing for exams. I don't know if any people here speak more languages, but learning a second language, and this seems like something that intuitively would make sense, is again increasing structural changes in the brain, and clearly something is going on here. Now, what is going on? How are all these different behaviors and skills, whether they are long-term and you're very expert, or whether they're short-term for some experiment, how are they actually leaving their mark on the brain? Because if I've said, look, resolutely, we want to see the physical changes, what is it? Now, in order to answer that, clearly no one's going to volunteer, human volunteers, but we turn to the rats, and sadly, you can't ask a rat to, well, you can ask a rat to drive a taxi and play the piano, but you won't get very far. So what you do with rats in order to look at the impact of their environment is a rather nice experiment, and this is from my own lab, actually, a so-called enriched environment. Now, enrichment for a rat doesn't mean to say they come to the Hawk Center, hopefully have an interesting evening, and go away arguing with each other and networking and whatever. For a rat, and you'll know they're highly exploratory creatures, this is nirvana for a rat. They love having things to play with and interact. Look how happy he looks. He's having a lovely time. He knows he's not in the control group. He's having a lovely time. So they're very happy, and you can compare their brain cells with the brain cells of the less fortunate control group who are kept in humane and healthy but pretty dull lab cages. And if you look at a brain cell from an animal in that condition, this is what you see, and I realize that this might look very odd to most of you, but let me just guide you through it. This blobby bit is the main part of the cell, the so-called cell body, but I'd like you to focus on the branches. Just look at the branches and compare those branches with that from a cell from an animal that was in this condition, and you can see, I hope, there's a difference. The branches are much more extensive. Now, why is this interesting or important? Well, we've just said that when you exercise anything, whether it's muscle or whether it's brain, it will respond, it will prosper and grow. If it doesn't get exercised, it won't. The way the brain expresses this growth is in the growth of the branches, as you can see. So a stimulating interactive environment makes brain cells work hard, and by working hard, they grow branches. Now, what is the benefit of having all these branches? Well, if you have all these branches, then you are increasing the surface area of the cell. And if you are increasing the surface area, it's going to be easier for other brain cells to make connections with you. So a stimulating environment makes brain cells work hard. As a consequence, they grow branches. And as a consequence of that, they can make connections with other brain cells more easily, as we've seen in those rather gross brain scans. But why does that matter anyway? What's so special about that? Well, I want to suggest to you, back to humans, that if you have connections, they give you a meaning to your life. Now, let's again unpack that concept. It helps you understand things and see significance. Imagine this. You're born, in the words of the great William James psychologist, into a booming, buzzing confusion. And all you can do as a little baby is evaluate the world in purely sensory terms. How sweet, how fast, how cold, how bright. In this case, gold shiny thing. Something a small child might be attracted to this object because it can roll. It's a pleasing reflective surface, it's smooth, you might try and put it in its mouth, you can stick things through it. So by virtue of its sensory properties, it will hold the child's attention. Now, as the weeks turn to months, turn to years, as those connections are forming as a result of the experience of interacting with an object like this, the child will learn that this is something that goes on fingers. And something that looks like this, as they're older, they will learn only goes specifically on one finger. And it only goes on one finger, usually under certain circumstances. So the child will learn that if they see someone with something on their finger that looks like this, as opposed to other things on fingers, that it will mean something. It will say something about the person. So we now have an association with this very simple object that gives it other meanings. And say when the child grows, they have one of their own, that particular ring will mean, let's hope, it will mean a lot to them, more than other rings. And if they then sadly go from the honeymoon to the divorce, it again will change in their attitudes. It will become perhaps the thing that evokes a huge amount of bitterness. And all this strong emotion and all this personalization this great meaning comes from what's gone on in the connections in your brain. It has nothing to do with the physical object itself. So you can see how the connections have enabled you to imbue this with a meaning that it doesn't have intrinsically. Similarly, your mum, when you're born, you see this sort of load of colours and blobs, an abstract pattern, and then gradually that becomes a face, and gradually it's a special face, a face that features more than other faces do, a face that therefore means a lot to you. Let's hope it's your mum. Now also, connections do other things, as well as helping you personalize the world around you. And we say in science that this gives you a cognitive take on the world, from the Latin cogito, I think. As well as that, it also enables you to make sense of the world. Now, had I come on this evening, this is a ghost, by the way. It's English ghost, that's what we all look like. Had I come on dressed like this, going woo, 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 I doubt if anyone would have found that particularly frightening. But if you're a very small child, they could well be frightened by something like that, as indeed could a patient with dementia. Because with dementia, what happens is these carefully crafted connections, which I'm going to argue are personalizing your brain into a mind. It's giving you a unique take on the world. Very sadly, in dementia, these are dismantled. So, and I'm sure there may be some people here whose lives have been touched by this tragic disease, what happens is the patient will regress, will recapitulate childhood again, and end up in the booming, buzzing confusion, where all you can do, as a small child can only do, take the world at face value. That's all you've got. You don't have the checks and balances of the adult mind that gives you a framework that enables you to see beyond face value. When you're a small child or a dementing patient, what you see is what you get. And if it's something novel, then it's potentially life-threatening, and therefore you could well be frightened by it. So connections free you up from that. They enable you to navigate the world and understand it in a way that the sensory properties alone do not help you do. So let's now apply this to how we can see us developing as people. You may be familiar, some of you, with the notion of fluid versus crystallized intelligence. As shown here in blue, the fluid intelligence is something that seems to peak in early adulthood, rather depressingly. What is meant by fluid intelligence, as its name suggests, is the ability to learn things quickly, to give the right outputs to the right inputs, and as we all know when we see how young people learn to drive quickly, for example, this is something that does characterize teenagers and young adults. You can learn very quickly, but sadly, this tails off in favor of something called crystalline intelligence, which actually I think is a much more powerful phenomena. Crystalline intelligence, as its name suggests, takes the image of a crystal. And this, I think, is very appropriate if we're thinking about brain-cell connections. Because instead of just having an input and giving the right output, as with fluid intelligence, what you do as you get older is you embed the event, the person, the fact, whatever it is coming in, into an existing structure, a neuronal connections, where you can relate one thing to another, so you understand it more. So for older people, although you might be slower to learn than a teenager, one argues that crystalline intelligence has enabled you to understand it better. So, for example, our education minister was a while ago, someone called Michael Gove, said that every child should learn a poem, and of course they could learn a poem. They can be like little parrots, of course they can do that. But surely the issue is more, how do you get them to understand the poem? And surely that's what we should be aiming for. So you can see that this idea of processing information in and out, as opposed to truly understanding, has already been documented for quite some time. And as a neuroscientist, one can actually relate that to the growth of the brain throughout life and the wonderful growth of the connectivity of your brain cells, which liberates you from the press of the moment. So I'd like to suggest to you that the biological basis of the mind is not some airy-fairy alternative to the physical brain. It is indeed the personalization of the brain through the unique dynamic configurations of your connections between your neurons that are driven in turn by your unique experiences that no one else will have ever again. So no wonder you're special, no wonder you're unique, because no one has a brain like yours, or rather, a mind like yours. So here you are, living your life in downtown Oxford, where we all are. And you can see everyone here It's like everyone in this room. Everyone is on a unique journey, a unique life story. All of us in this room have a present that is informed directly, indirectly, consciously, subconsciously, by our past, by a sequence of events, beginning, middle, and end. And hopefully this is informing us to have a long and successful and happy and fulfilling future. It's our life story, no one else's. It's yours, it's special to you. And it's your identity, effectively. This is what you are, your life story. And it's all due to the connections in your brain, of which you have up to 100,000. That is the end of the neuroscience course. But it does make me think of a lovely quote from a British journalist called Ben McIntyre, shown here, thinking of this notion of a life story and journeys, and I'll read it. From the moment we become aware of others, we demand to be told stories that allow us to make sense of the world, to inhabit the mind of someone else. In old age, we tell stories to make small museums of memory. It matters not whether the stories are true or imaginary. The narrative, whether oral or written, is a staple of every culture in the world over. But stories demand time and concentration. The narrative does not simply transmit information, but invites the reader or listener to witness the unfolding of events. And that's something I want to come back to. You can see probably where I'm building up here in developing this notion of a linearity of thought, of that being a life story, and the importance of, as you can see here, time and concentration to develop and make the most of our human birthright in terms of what it means to be us. Okay, so that's the end of the course. Now we're coming on to another conclusion now. The conclusion is, and I don't think anyone will challenge me on this, the 21st century environment is unprecedented. Because if we are so shaped by our environment, surely the next thing is to look at the features of that environment and see from the goods and services that are out there, not just the science papers, let's just look at the goods and services, because that captures the zeitgeist of a cultural society. So here we go, what about this? I mean, this is not a joke. When I sometimes show this, people think it's a joke. Okay, here we are. And people say it's not changing. Or this. Or this, multitasking. Yeah. These things, especially the child on the right, these things are absolutely normal now as part of our society to see. And parents, some parents think that this shows they're highly intelligent and it's fantastic they're interacting with the screen in this way. And in fact, if one looks at the statistics and I'm sure many of you have children or grandchildren in these age groups. Look at this, the total technology time. That accounts for multitasking and adding. It was 18 hours a day. And that is a peer review paper, 2014. So there we are. So it's unquestionable that young people are spending a lot of time engaged in digital technologies. What also fascinates me, again, you look away from the papers, at just what people do with their time in front of a screen, is this kind of thing. Does anyone recognize? No, they won't fess up. This is something called planking, where, as far as I can understand it, you lie down like this, and then you do it in funny things like this or like this, and you look on YouTube. And that's it. That's it. But that's the whole point. Now, if at some stage, if someone perhaps offline can just explain to me why this is a good thing to do with the limited time we have on this planet, it would be really great to know that. You know? But, and say, you know, an ancient Greek came back from 5th century Athens and looked at this. I wonder what they would think of us. You know, if they'd just been watching some ancient play and they would looked at the human beings doing this with culture. So I just put that before you, that this is what some people spend their time doing. Similarly, if you look at good ways of making money from people's obsession, this is a great way. I'd love to have done this. I don't know if you're familiar with this app called Freedom. But again, the idea is that you are incapable of turning off your own internet. Yeah. So therefore, you pay someone else to do it. Isn't that a fantastic way of making money? It's called freedom. And they give you freedom, these people. They kind of pull out the plug for you and you pay them. This is true. I promise you I'm not making these things up. It's real. And then back to more formal surveys. This is from one of the British press, from Ofcom, which is our communications watchdog. Now people are spending more time in front of the screen than in bed. Please don't ask me, what about if you work on your iPad in bed? I don't know. But nonetheless, you can see that there are issues here where I think looking at the goods and services, looking at the formal reports, looking at the peer-reviewed studies, it is all pointing to a different type of world, a world where someone can get up and they can work and they can go shopping and they can go dating and they can play games all without interacting with another human being. And I challenge anyone to say that that's the same as the printing press or the car, which is what some people try and say. So I call this mind change, as you've heard, because I think there are comparisons with climate change, as shown here in this rather overworked image of the two hands. But nonetheless, I think it proves its point, because it's in our hands to do something about it in both cases. So both are global, both are unprecedented, I would argue, both are controversial, and both are multifaceted, and that's what I want to spend the rest of the talk exploring with you. By multifaceted, I mean there's not a simple question, are computers good or bad? That's like saying, is a car good or bad? But way more complex. And as someone once said, for every complex situation, there's always a simple answer, and it's always wrong. So what we have to do is to step back a little bit and take a deep breath and look at the various issues involved, rather like with climate change. However, whereas climate change, as far as I understand it, is damage limitation, we're just trying to put the brakes on, with mind change, it doesn't have to be like that. Mind change could be the most exciting time for all of us to decide how we are going to harness this technology so it's not an end in and of itself, but it's a means to an end. And surely that's what the technology is there for. It's a means to an end. But what is the end you want? If you're going to live to be 100, what are you going to do with the second 50 years of your life? Just play Grand Theft Auto. Wouldn't that be sad? So, you know, so what we're going to do is just unpack a little bit, we're coming into three, and see how things are changing. Now, this is the next conclusion, which is pretty obvious, that if the brain is sensitive to the environment's changing, the brain's going to be changing also. And this is just one study of many that are coming out, whereas the yellow blobby bits are showing microstructural abnormalities in heavy internet users. So let's unpack this, first for social networking. How often do we see this? Yeah? No eye contact? Yeah, it's not an advert for Pepsi, it's more the eye contact. And this is one of the issues that we need to think about, because when you communicate with someone, words have only 10% of impact most typically. When you first meet someone, I'm not going to be unfair, actually I will on Paul, I'll do it on him. You know, you stare someone in the eye. After a while, it freaks them out. Exactly. They feel like Paul's looking uncomfortable. You know, his body language is fishing. Sitting there. Similarly, if you don't look someone in the eye at all, say, Paul, I'm talking to you, you know, after a while, that is really, really unnerving. So eye contact is totally important, and how much you sustain eye contact for when you look away depends very much on how well you know the person, the nature of your relationship, but it is a hugely important form of interpersonal communication and of understanding how other people might be feeling, establishing empathy and the like. So eye contact's really important, as is body language. You're not going to confide in someone if they're folding their arms and their eyes are reversed and they're looking away, whereas if they're nodding at you and patting your arm and smiling, you may feel more disposed to confiding in someone. Then we have voice. You don't have to speak another language to know if someone is angry or sad or happy from the tone, the rate, and the volume in which they're speaking. Pheromones, these sneaky chemicals that no one really can consciously detect in humans, but underlies sometimes, you know, you say, oh, the chemistry wasn't right. I don't know, I just didn't hit it off with them. Oh, I did, you know, we just hit it off straight. We're on the same wavelength. I don't know why. It was fantastic. That could be in part these sneaky subconscious chemicals that you smell, that you pick up on. And then, of course, the minefield of all physical contact, where and how and when you touch someone, even in a business context, as these two gentlemen are touching each other, but they're very careful where they're touching each other and how long they're touching each other for. And again, this is something you have to learn. But it is one of the most powerful ways of expressing how you feel or picking up on someone else. When my father died in 2011 and someone just put their arm around me, I still remember it, as opposed to someone just texting me saying, sorry, your dad died. You know, it's not quite the same thing. So eye contact, body language, voice, pheromones, and physical contact are going to be essential for establishing a close relationship with someone, for empathy with someone, for understanding how they're feeling, for, again, being the full gamut of what we call being a human being, doing those things and having a close relationship. And yet, none of those things are available on Facebook. So if you take a young person, and I will say a young person who hasn't had the experiences of friendships and interpersonal communication and face-to-face skills, haven't developed those things. If you are communicating, as reports are showing, with your thumbs rather than your voice, if you're not looking someone in the eye, when are you going to become good at those things? And if you're not good at those things, then you're going to find it aversive when you do meet someone. You're going to feel very uncomfortable. You know, if someone sees you go red and wipe your sweaty palms on your jeans and sees you gulp, you know, you're going to feel uncomfy. So you're going to avoid doing those things, and it will be a vicious cycle whereby you'll prefer to communicate offline in this way. So this means that we might be seeing a decline in empathy because we are not looking someone in the face. See, what body language has done, it's nature's way of establishing a handbrake. Human beings love talking about themselves. And there's a wonderful study from Harvard, which is unbelievable but true, where people, instead of having monetary reward, preferred the opportunity to talk about themselves. Can you believe that? So any employers here, next time your employer wants a pay rise, just say, no, you won't have a pay rise, you can talk about yourself for half an hour instead. That would be an amazing idea. Yeah? But we love talking about ourselves because, again, evolution, that means that we'll be, you know, copulating and reproducing and you know, surviving in a much more efficient way than if we're living in isolation. So it's ingrained in us to do this. So what nature's done very cleverly is put on body language so you just don't do it all over the place, non-specifically and excessively with anyone you meet. You will only do it as you establish a relationship, as you, through body language and voice tone and so on, and physical contact and eye contact, gradually you will feel you can trust that person and you will start to open up to them, literally open up. You'll confide in them in a way that you wouldn't with someone who just met or who has their arms folded. Enter social networking sites where that handbrake is removed, where now you have the natural biological urge to talk about yourself, but at the same time you don't have the handbrake on. So off you go, talking about yourselves, and guess what happens? You meet with people, you're divulging to people that you never met before possibly, who are more like an audience rather than friends, who demand to be entertained, who you've got to impress. So off you go, rattling away. And what a surprise when you get spiteful, unpleasant, cruel comments back that truly upset you, that undermine your self-esteem further, which means that you're going to fabricate or exaggerate a wonderful lifestyle that none of us have. So it's a real issue we need to explore on how people are interacting. And it's not surprising, there's, as you can see here, empathy is now declining. It's declined over the last 30 years, particularly marked in the last 10. This is a study of 14,000 college students. Similarly, and this is a sensitive issue, but we have to look at it and we have to face up to it. It would follow that if you have issues when you're in the screen, you don't need to use skills relating to empathy, then people who have a natural impairment in that direction anyway, people with autistic spectrum disorder, might feel more comfortable on the screen, and indeed it's the case. And I'd suggest to you that, controversially, when we are online, when we are engaged in screen activities, what you see is what you get. You are not using the skills that autistic people have problems with anyway, and the playing field is level. Everyone is just judging by actions. You're not using body language, voice tone, eye contact, and so on. So none of us are empathetic. Yeah. And indeed, there is a link now between autistic type behavior, and I do stress autistic type behavior. So for example, you can take people's EEGs, their brain waves, and most people will, if you show them a face or show them a door, they will have an exaggerated EEG response to the face. People with autistic spectrum have a similar response to both. Heavy internet users have a similar profile to those on autistic spectrum, as you can see. There's a link between autistic spectrum disorders and an underfunctioning part of the brain we're going to come to in a minute, which is indicative of a very literal take on the world, where what you see is what you get. There's a link between early screen experiences and the later development of autism, a link between autistic conditions and the appeal of screen technologies, and I would argue that is because the playing field is level, and a link between autistic spectrum disorders and compulsive video game use. Now, I deliberately put the references up here. You can find them on my website and in my book anyway, because inevitably I got fed up with people saying, Baroness says computers cause autism, which of course I'm not saying, but I'm saying that if people don't rehearse the skills that autistic people have problems with anyway, then they're not going to be good at them either, and this could be linked to the screen technology, which doesn't encourage that kind of rehearsal. So that's all I'm saying, and the papers are there. Of course, we need to do more, but we're doing no one a service by pretending these papers don't exist and these findings aren't there. Okay, so what does that say about your identity? And I think we can look at the history of blogging to see not just how we see other people, but how we see ourselves. So 99, I just have to tell someone about this thing my cat did today. You know what's coming, don't you, of course. Flickr, 2004, oh my God, cat pictures. 2005, YouTube, moving cat pictures. Yes, you got it, that pinnacle of civilization, Twitter. 2007, 1 p.m. cat has just sneezed. 102, cat sneezed again. 104, cat hasn't sneezed recently, getting worried. Yeah. And that's why I was horrified to hear there might be Twitter conversations going on. Please listen to what I'm saying. You can Twitter afterwards. But you know, why this obsession with downloading everything you're doing? I don't get it. You know, people now download pictures of chocolate cake they're about to eat or hamburgers. Or, why is that interesting? Again, it's like playing, why? Why do people want to, why would other people want to see a chocolate cake or to know about your cat or to know you're putting your sock on? Why would they want to know these things? You know, if you say, have just split the atom, you know, or have just discovered how the brain generates consciousness or just solve the economic problems of the world, yes, go ahead, tweet, you know, but for these things, I truly don't get it, unless, you see, so this is my theory, that these people are in some kind of existential crisis, you know, that like a small child, look at me, mummy, I'm putting on one sock, look at me, I'm putting on another sock, look at what I've just done, mummy, look at me, you're self-referential because you need that, because you don't have a robust sense of your own identity. You need to be constantly reassured and be given feedback all the time, and here Twitter is doing this for you. And another goods and services, if you wanted, if you're worried about how important you were, you can sign up to Clout, yeah, and that gives you a number that tells you how important you are. relating to your social networking. So there we go. Again, I take my hat off to them for thinking of an ingenious way of making money out of people's fallibility like this, but the thing is they are fallible. This is a business that's thriving on people's vanity, basically, or insecurity. And indeed, a peer-reviewed paper, yes, indeed, there is a growth in narcissism and a decrease in self-esteem related to social networking sites. Not if you're friends with the person and they go and live in the UK and you keep up with them like that, that's just fine. The problem arises when you have 500 or 1,000 friends that you've never met before. Because let's be brutal, they are not really friends, are they? They're people that you might know what chocolate cake they've just eaten, or you might know that the cat has just sneezed, but have you shared life crises with them? Have you sat up all night with them? Have you had them sob in your arms? No, you have not. They are not close friends. And I think they should be given a different word or something like that. And it devalues terms. And so how unsurprising that they use devalued words like hate or go kill yourself, because they do not know the impact that has, because these are just words that people use, a hater. Whereas for, you know, if someone actually looks you in the eye and says, I hate you, you know, that's not trivial, that has a huge impact, and yet it's become devalued by people that have not had that experience. So here you are, there's a sort of a weaker sense of identity, because that's constructed externally, and I think this is very interesting in relation to privacy. And let me just float you my thoughts on privacy, which go hand in hand with identity, I would argue. The very notion of being private is, in a good way, shutting something out. So, for example, if you want to be private and you draw the curtains across your window, yeah, or you close the door, or you go somewhere quiet to make that private phone call, the whole notion of privacy is the exclusion of others from some special inner activity or thing or our identity. And the very word privation, of course, means to deprive someone of something. So in a good sense, privacy involves exclusion, having a wall, whether it's a curtain, whether it's the far wall of your body, whether it's a robust inner identity, whatever it is, there's you and there's outside. And that's what gives you a strong sense of who you are. And I fear that if people are constantly downloading every single thought they have, there is no firewall, there is no privacy. So no wonder perhaps younger people find it hard to understand why older people put such a premium on privacy. And perhaps that comes in turn by the fact that when you're growing up until now, you have been able to keep your thoughts to yourself. They're not downloaded every moment. You know? And you have a strong sense of narrative. It's not driven from outside. You know, a tree doesn't ask you to climb it, and a drawing pad doesn't ask you to draw in it. Your dolls or your soldiers didn't ask you to play with them. The box the present comes in doesn't ask you to turn it into a castle or a car. this imagination does it, something inside you. You're driving the narrative, you're making up the game. Do you remember when you're saying as a kid, let's make up a game? Let's make up a game. Doesn't that make you excited just saying that? I feel like saying, John, let's make up a game. You'd be cowboys, I'd be Indians, I'll be the fairy princess, whatever. Yeah. It's all coming from inside. And if instead you're spending a lot of your childhood sitting in front of someone else's imagination, someone else's images, in front of fixed menus, in front of a very vociferous and demanding audience on social networking sites, is it any wonder that the 18 to 25-year-olds in a recent Australian psychology report are showing more stress and anxiety and depression? Not because, inevitably, there's always stresses and strains in life. These, sadly, are in every generation. But the whole trick is to be able to cope with those things and to have a strong confidence in who you are. And what I worry about is that we are eroding that confidence. And this was echoed by the science minister, our science advisor to the government, someone called John Beddington, in 2013. You can download this. It was a report on what he called the volatile nature of identity in the face of social networking. And it bristles with pie charts and histograms and all the things civil servants like, and lots of statistics. And you can just get it on the web, just download it. So I think there's many things we need to think about in terms of identity in a very deep sense, and in terms of how we communicate with each other, because surely that is central to the kind of society we live in, and how we work together, and the kind of relationships we have, both privately and professionally. Okay, let's go on to gaming. Okay, this is someone with an attentional problem. I don't know how familiar this looks. And one says, well, you know, if you have a young brain with the evolutionary mandate to adapt to the environment, and if the environment is, as is the case in video games, a very fast-paced one, otherwise why not go out and climb a tree? It's something that, you know, is designed to manipulate you and keep you playing the game, that gives you high arousal and excitement. And that's what you obligingly adapt to, because that's what brains do. You adapt to the environment, you'll adapt to that environment. Then you go to a school and you have to sit still for half an hour. You're going to fidget a bit, obviously, if you haven't rehearsed sitting still. If you've never rehearsed that, if you've never had someone read you a story, if you've never focused and concentrated, but you're constantly in front of something that is distracting you from moment to moment, is it any wonder you'll have a short attention span? So that indeed is being the case. Here's some papers that are coming out. Television and video game exposure, development of attentional problems, video game playing, and impulsiveness with a bidirectional causality. So, again, there's evidence coming out for that. As is, we look at the clinical picture, the increase in prescriptions for drugs, of which the generic name is methylphenidate, but you'd recognize Ritalin, for example, as one of the brand names of such drugs. Now, could doctors be prescribing more liberally, or could the condition now be more medicalized of ADHD, or could it just be, and this is not mutually exclusive, you take a young brain with the evolutionary mandate to adapt to the environment demands short attention, you have a short attention. End of. And I think we should really be exploring that also. Then there's issues of aggression, and I wonder if you can see the common feature in these most popular video games last year. Grand Theft Auto, Batman, Assassin's Creed, Call of Duty, and Battlefield. The clue is in the last one, I think, probably. Yes, they're all violent videos. They're all violent video games. Leading to this kind of behavior. How would you like to work with people like this? Yeah. Okay. So the idea is here that brains of any age, of course, you're adapting to the environment. And if you adapt to an environment that is characterized by violence, and by that will become the default. You'll become desensitized. You'll adapt to that. And this is a brain scan showing exactly that, that repeated exposure to media violence, you have a diminished response in a key part of the brain that is not there, as you can see on the right, with control stimuli. So we know that happens. We know that people, after a short period of time playing violent video games, that becomes your thermostat setting. So that now you're not going to go out and say and be violent. There's nothing between violence and aggression. What will happen is you'll have a more adversarial approach to people. So say someone bumped into you in the corridor, instead of saying, oh, I'm sorry. You know, so who do you think you're shoving? You know, a bit like British football players, fans are. You know, that's sort of rather violent. And indeed, this is, again, a controversial issue, but if you look at a meta-analysis of 136 papers, there we are, 381 tests, 130,000 participants, the conclusion is, yes, you get desensitization, increased arousal, aggressive cognition, aggressive behaviors. Are we surprised? No, because of the same idea. Another aspect of video games that people worry about a lot is addiction. And of course, this is a very loaded word, so let's say compulsive use of video games. And as shown here, our Daily Telegraph is different from your Daily Telegraph, by the way. It's this is a very right-wing so-called quality paper, which I don't think your Telegraph is. It's a different one. But anyway, so our Telegraph has this, you can see the title is Children Who Love Video Games Have Brains Like Gamblers. This is the paper they were citing, and this does raise the issue of what is it that happens in the brain if you are playing compulsive video games, and what is it that is similar to addiction and to gambling and gambling addiction. And here, this area of the brain here in yellow is the area that's enhanced in all cases. This is yet another paper showing a link between addiction and video games. And what it's all about is this area that's enlarged is releasing a very important chemical in the brain. It's very well known. And it's linked to all drugs of addiction, irrespective of what the drug is, whether it's cannabis or morphine or heroin. In the brain, what happens is eventually it will release a chemical, a very hard-working chemical, indirectly, that's also released when you're excited, and it's also released during a reward. That's a reward, in case you wonder what rewards look like. What is this chemical? You'll have heard of it. It's dopamine. I'm sure you've heard of dopamine. Now, what dopamine, and that surges during video games. Okay. Now, what does dopamine do? Well, it acts like a fountain in the brain. It does many things. It's related to movement. For example, it dwindles in Parkinson's disease. It underlies reward and arousal. But for our purposes, what I want to draw your attention to is it inhibits an important part of the brain that I mentioned just now with autism, the prefrontal cortex, which is, as its name suggests, in the front. Now, why should that be important or interesting that dopamine inhibits the prefrontal cortex? Let's look a bit more at that. This part of the brain shown here in turquoise occupies 33% of the human brain, 17% in chimps, so that you can see in evolutionary terms, it's clearly a very sophisticated area. In neuroscience, we've gone beyond now saying what's the function of this area or that, but we do know that when it underfunctions, certain profiles emerge which we can look at. So here are the two basic modes. We can call it the meaningless mode, if you like, as opposed to the meaningful mode. And when the prefrontal is underfunctioning, the profile you see is one of very strong feelings, as opposed to thinking dominating. Your senses are driving what's happening, as opposed to the cognitive. You're living in the here and now, with a literal take on the world, as opposed to this past, present, and future, which, as we have seen, characterizes your life story as you develop your mind. The external environment drives moment to moment. So it's like with a small child, and this is very much the infant and young child profile. Say a young kid has an ice cream and it falls on the pavement, the kid cries. One strategy is to say, oh, look at the birdie. And suddenly all the tears stop and looks at the birdie. Now, if you do that with a depressed adult, you're not going to get very far with that. Yeah? Because they have the inner narrative going on. So we have an internal perceptions. The external world has little meaning. What you see is what you get. Think of the wedding ring. Here, personalized meaning. Think of the wedding ring. Here, there's a reduced sense of self. Here, you have a strong notion of your identity, who you are. Here's no time and space. You're just in the moment. Here, there's a clear time-space reference. And if you have damaged the prefrontal cortex, there's a condition called source amnesia, where you still have generic kind of hazy memories, but you can't remember episodes or context in which they occurred. This is mainly infants and children. What's very interesting with evolution is that just as we've seen that we have 33%, whereas the chimps have only 17%, so that is reflected, as is often the case in biology, by children, in that really what's exciting and interesting is the prefrontal cortex is only fully matured in late teenage years, early 20s. So just like in evolution, it comes on very late. In adolescence, you're having the biggest surge of dopamine you will ever have, if there's any teenagers here, which dwindles as we get older. And so you can see that's connected also with inhibiting the prefrontal cortex. So these are the two modes that we've always had. And what really interests me about human beings is sometimes we've wanted to go to that left-hand column, but we've had to contrive how we do it with wine, women, and song. Or drugs and sex and rock and roll, which is the same equivalent. And how have we done that? This is from a Greek vase, an ancient Greek vase. I don't know if there are any classicists here from the play by Euripides called The Bacchae, where this poor benighted King Pentheus is about to be torn apart by these crazed women who are worshipping the wine god Dionysus. Yeah? And so even in those days, one could think of human beings having what perhaps we would now call a sensational time. If I said, let's go out now and have a cognitive time, no one's going to come with me, are they? Whereas sensational time, which is driving the senses, is what's really exciting. You let yourself go. You blow your mind. You're out of your mind. The word ecstasy in Greek is to stand outside of yourself. And this is what I got a while ago, funnily enough, from Queensland when I was visiting. Here we are. You can be totally out of control. You pay money to do this. Hovercraft fun ride. I don't know if this chap wants his money back. But so the whole notion is it's always been like this. And I would suggest to you that wine, women and song, drugs and sex and rock and roll are ways, very contrived ways, in which we've taken agents that will impair our connections by impairing the transmitters, or we've put ourselves in a world stripped of all cognitive content, as shown here. Or, you know, you go to a rave, techno. You go somewhere, there's flashing lights and lots of noise that doesn't mean anything. It's just the strong senses. So it's always been like this. And what's very interesting is whether this mode now is on the increase that we want to do. Another group of people that have an under-functioning prefrontal cortex are people who have a high body mass index, such as this poor child, namely who are obese. That's where your weight is heavy relative to your height. And what's very interesting is obese people are reckless in gambling tasks. Isn't that an interesting connection? As are schizophrenics, who also have an underfunctioning prefrontal cortex. Now, these are all very different conditions, schizophrenia, obesity, childhood, reckless gambling, but they seem to all have something in common. They're all characterized by an underfunctioning prefrontal cortex. Schizophrenia, a complex condition we don't have time to discuss properly, nonetheless has many similarities with children. Both are easily distracted, neither have a long attention span, neither can interpret problems. If you say to a schizophrenic, what does it mean people who live in glass houses mustn't throw stones? They'll say something like, well, if your house is made of glass and you throw a stone, your house will break. You know, they've kind of missed the point. And they both have underfunctioning prefrontal cortex. So what could be going on here? Well, anyone who eats knows the consequence of eating. But the thrill of the food for an obese person is trumping the consequences. And anyone who gambles knows the consequence of gambling, but the thrill of the roulette wheel or the roll of the dice trumps the consequences. You're going to lose all your money. What's that got to do with schizophrenia? Well, I think that gives us the clue. This is from a series of paintings by a schizophrenic where everyone would recognize this as a cat, but as the condition deteriorates, I would challenge you to recognize that as a cat. Although artistically, you might prefer it, but you know, clearly. What I suggest is that we've gone here, instead of going from sensory to cognitive, is we've gone in a reverse direction. So an underfunctioning prefrontal cortex, what it's doing is actually emphasizing the sensational at the expense of the cognitive. So you're back in that left-hand column again. So what has that got to do with risk management? Because surely if you're in an environment where actions don't have consequences, where you're living in the moment, that would be very important, surely, for these two basic modes. And the whole point of what I'm saying is, whilst it's been ever thus, are we now seeing a situation where the world of the video games present as it does a world without consequences, without risk, of strong excitement and thrill of the moment, with diminished sense of identity, that we are swaying things artificially in that direction? So that intense stimulation of the screen mandates a fast response. You're very excited, so dopamine is going to be released. That underlies reward-seeking addictive behavior, so you carry on doing it. More dopamine is released. It inhibits the prefrontal cortex. This brings about a mindset comparable to children, schizophrenics, and obesity. So you'll now have a drive for sensation rather than cognition. Where are you best going to find that? You're going to find it on the screen. So around we go. And how many people recognize this? YOLO. The younger people, yeah. I feel like a spy from another time. So the idea is, for those of you who are not familiar with it, is you go out and do something outrageous, and then you inevitably put it on Facebook, and then you justify it by saying, YOLO, you only live once. Yeah. And I think that captures the zeitgeist of the moment. Finally, search engines and how we are learning from those. If you asked a Martian what honor was, I wonder what you'd say, or a child. If you Google on honor, because it's the UK, the Queen comes up first, of course. Get her, and then you get these things. But would you be able to explain to someone through that what honor really was? An abstract concept? You can't use icons and visual displays, as happens with screen technologies, to convey abstract concepts. And similarly, meaning. Again, if you play a video game, do you care about this princess in the video game? But you don't care about her at all. You don't care about her, whereas you would care about this princess in Tolstoy. So what's the difference between the two princesses? They're both fictional. I'll suggest to you the princess in the book is like you. She has a past like you. She has connections like you. She has relationships like you. She has a life story. Again, we're back to stories. A life story just like you, which is why she has a meaning and a significance just like you. And that is why you keep turning the pages, whereas the princess in the video game is an icon. And there's someone here who agrees with me, some grumpy person agrees with me. I worry that the level of interrupt, the sort of overwhelming rapidity of information, is affecting cognition. It's affecting deeper thinking. The story, remember. I still believe sitting down and reading a book is the best way to learn something. I worry that we're losing that. The chairman of Google. Okay? Similarly, the spread of possible misinformation, as flagged by the World Economic Forum last year, the so-called digital wildfire of being hyper-connected, where you are not anymore differentiating validity from non-validity, of solid information from weaker information, where you're just inputting and outputting with your tweets and everything is treated similarly. Sadly, that may be an issue we have to face. So finally, because I realize the time is pressing, what will be the mindset of the 21st century given all this? Well, there's some positives, like a high IQ, because if you're rehearsing mental agility, as is mandated by video games, then you'll be very good at IQ tests. Similarly, you'll have efficient information processing. But information isn't knowledge. And just because you can recite the poem doesn't mean to say you understand it, as we've seen. A short attention span, icons, not ideas, sensation at a premium, a risk taker, low empathy, and the need for constant feedback, and a weak sense of identity and low-grade aggression. These are the things we've just looked at. And for me, this profile is not one of a robot. This profile one is of an infant, a small child. You know, it's a high emotion, needy, insecure, needing attention and feedback all the time, slightly aggressive. And I just wonder if that's the direction that we might be going in. And if so, how can we finally realize the full potential? Not so much that they're going to be robots or like this, I wonder. I'm going to show this one day, and this person's going to be on the front row as the professor somewhere. This is the world stripped of all cognitive content. You know, technically. So. And I think a clue comes from a prediction, a brilliant prediction from 50 years ago by Isaac Asimov. Even so, mankind will suffer badly. This is 1964, he was predicting what was going to happen in 2014. Even so, mankind will suffer badly from the disease of boredom, a disease spreading more widely each year and growing in intensity. This will have serious mental, emotional, and sociological consequences. I dare say the psychiatry will be far and away the most important medical speciality in 2014. Now, the most important thing. The lucky few who can be involved in creative work of any sort will be the true elite of mankind. And get this, for they alone will do more than serve a machine. Isn't that prescient? Now, the only thing I would disagree with there is why do we have to have an elite? Why can't we all be creative in some way? Because if you're creative, if you're joining up the dots in a way no one's joined up the dots before, then you have a strong sense of identity. It doesn't have to be writing a symphony or cracking the atom. It can be rearranging the kitchen in a new way. It can be just seeing the world differently and interpreting that. So I'd like to suggest that where we should be headed is using this information, harnessing the technology, to shape an environment that facilitates, we can't dial it up, but will facilitate the possibility of having new ideas. So you take a fact, relate it to other facts, and that's what we've seen make something significant. Think of the wedding ring. The more you can place facts into a wider conceptual framework, the more deeply you understand them. An example of that was my little brother, who I used to torture routinely because I hated him when he was 3 and I was 16. And I forced him to learn Shakespeare because I just thought it was very funny. And he would parrot out, you know, tomorrow and tomorrow creeps in this petty pace from day to day. And someone said that would go down a storm in playgroup. But anyway, it goes on, that line, out, out, brief candle, life is but a poor player. And had you said to him, Graham, what does that mean, out, out, brief candle? He would say, rather like with the schizophrenic in the glass house, oh, I have a candle on my birthday cake and I blow it out. He wouldn't have seen the parallel between the extinction of the candle and the extinction of life. For that, you need to make associations and connections, and you understand something, eureka. So then you go from understanding. Now, if you can make unprecedented connections, the way a great physiologist from this country, Burnett, did, where he saw a link between Darwinian evolution, natural selection, and the immune system, astonishing, creative, insightful, wonderful, new significance and understanding, that's what is a new idea. Surely that's what we want for society, don't we? Don't we want to learn society where people have lots of ideas, and that gives them a sense of fulfillment, it gives them a sense of identity, and it makes them ideally useful in society. And that's where I want to live. I want to live there. I don't want to live with a load of people playing video games. I want to do that. So I've cited a lot of references, and inevitably people say there's no evidence for what I'm saying. And as I said on Q&A, you're welcome to your own views. You're not welcome to your own facts, which are there. And here we go. So if you go to Science Screen Technology reading list, as you will see, the references are there, and you make up your own mind. If you don't want to plow through 500 technical papers, there's an easier option, and that is a shameless plug for my book, which is now out in Australia, which doesn't bring tablets down from the mountain, as I said at the beginning. Really, it just lays out the issues and invites you to discuss and argue, because when we do that, we have a healthy society. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. We've got time for questions.
Thank you so much. Now, we have time just for a couple of questions. There's a hand right up the back there. Can you wait for the microphone, please, because we are recording? And only one other question. I'm sorry, we've running out of time.
But can I just say, yeah. If you have a question, you can go onto my website where there's a space, you can put your question there, and I'll try and answer it. I won't be able to do it immediately, but if you do have a question, you do have a vehicle there for...
Thank goodness for technology.
Yep.
Okay, so the man up there and then the lady just here.
Susan, I've wondered whether the common viewing of television programs and earlier from my parents' age, movies of the 1930s and 40s and 50s by some of the great writers who were teachers, who were teaching moral stories so often. And that commonality bred an empathy between humans because everybody had seen that same group of programs. I just wonder whether there's been any research done in that direction.
Thank you for that. I think we're here looking at a continuum where we start with books or the oral telling of a story around the campfire through to a film or a TV program through to something that's more interactive on the screen. And I find it very interesting that people will usually say that the book is better than the film. Now, let's just unpack that. The reason I think the book is usually better than the film is you are using something that the screen has the least chance of you using, the book the most, and the TV comes in the middle, is your imagination. And I think what people sometimes don't realize is that stories aren't just little fairy stories. They're not just action, where you have goodies and baddies. As we mature, the whole point of stories is they give you insights into how other people are thinking and feeling, as you rightly say. And so whilst a little fairy story, or dare I say it, the plot of a video game, is all about intergalactic warfare and baddies and goodies, and you know, you can't imagine Jane Austen being a video game, can you? You can't, you know, or Kafka being a video game. So the whole point, and I say it comes in a range, is that we progress from simple action, simple stories of very easy concepts and characters, such as would be in the video game, and what a book does, and to a certain extent a good film or TV program does, is enable you to see into the minds of others, and that is, as you rightly say, very important for empathy. To the best of my knowledge, no one's done a study on that, but I think it is really important, and that's why I showed that Ben McIntyre quote about stories at the beginning. I think you need fiction to help you understand facts. Any other? One more question, I think.
Okay, thank you. My question relates to some research that I read, but because I'm not a London taxi driver, I don't actually remember the name of the people who produced the research, but it said that they'd done a very broad survey of what was the best way for people to release stress, and it was comparing men to women.
Yeah.
And it said that women, the best stress release for them was to go shopping, and the best stress release for men was to play computer games. Just wanted your thoughts on that.
One of the arguments that has been used for violent video games is it releases, it's a safety valve for aggression. But what I question there is, why you're feeling aggressive in the first place or violent in the first place. Because whilst hunger and sex are natural drives that mount up and need some kind of release, you don't have an urge to be violent every day and then you need release. It's usually triggered from something on the outside. And I think that helping people cope with that, there must be easier ways than encouraging them to play fictional violent games, you know, that if one could actually understand why people are feeling stressed. And again, I go back to this study that I heard about when I first came to Australia 2 weeks ago, that it's the 18 to 25s who are coping the least well with stress. Yeah. Perhaps everyone should go shopping, that would be the easiest.
Good. I'd like to just spend a minute or two thanking Baroness Greenfield for just this phenomenal experience that we've had tonight in terms of your lecture. I'm one of the ones with the dwindling dopamine stores, but I'd like to highlight one thing that I think is absolutely impressive, and that is Baroness Greenfield has really highlighted that the brain is the frontier, and it really is. In 50,000 years, where our brain has gone from an entity of about 800 grams to about 1.2 kilograms, we've been very good at mapping the brain in terms of its transmitters, as you saw, and its connections, and so on and so forth. But what Baroness Greenfield has done this evening has shown us that the real challenge is the interaction between those structures and our environment. And really, in many ways, provoked us to think about what that interaction is. And for that, I'd thank you deeply for your presentation, and I'd ask you all to join with me in thanking Baroness Greenfield. Thank you.